Now, I'm kind of hesitant to make this video because I really don't know too much about what's the I don't know too much about the background or the history of Libya, and I just don't know the issue that well. But I just think it's just fascinating that there's just so much revolution going around in this part of the world, especially now. It started with Tunisia, the uprising there, which inspired Egyptians to really to go out and protest using social media, not using social media, sorry for my pronunciation, using social media like Facebook and Twitter to organize protest movements to say, hey, they make a tweet saying, we're gonna be here at this block, and 3,000 people gather up and they protest and they make a peaceful protest. The military counters back and they scream, Mubarak must go. And there's just been a surge of uprisings throughout this region, throughout North America, throughout Middle East. It's been amazing, and it's the efforts are still going in so many different countries like Syria, Egypt, Tunisia, and most recently, of course, Libya. And all this, it's been going. It's I think it started pretty much in January like 16th or 14th is the most. Is the date that everyone kind of, because I started following Twitter to a lot of activists and journalists around that region, so I started following those Twitter tweets, and they I think that's the date they really mark hashtagged a lot, January 15th, I think, I'm not really sure, but anyway, that's kind of when it started, and throughout that time, the Western media, I feel like, hasn't really covered, or there hasn't been any interest in what's going on around the world. All these revolutions, people fighting for democracy, pretty much, people fighting to end the rule of tyrants or rulers who've been like that for 40 years. These are like the kings and monarchs of the world in that region that hasn't been disposed of yet, and really violating or abusing their power against the people. So there is this surge of uprising, and the media kind of ignores it for the most part. I guess except for certain ones like Al Jazeera, I think. I'm not sure. I haven't been following around news that much. I've been kind of politically apathetic and awake for a long time, and I'm now finally starting to kind of reawaken to it. But yeah, so there hasn't been any coverage. I really didn't know what was going on other than the tweets I was following. The tweets would, and the people there, the actual people there in the uprisings would talk a lot about what was going on and stuff like that. It was really interesting. Every day I would wake up, I'll see my Twitter feed, and it just feel like the whole world was just like, it felt like the world was undergoing a revolution. And then I walk outside my apartment and was just like, wow, nobody really knows or cares. So, and even like when President Obama kind of made a speech in regards to the Egyptian uprising, it really wasn't much of a statement. It was kind of very wishy-washy, kind of just like, "What? So, what is the U.S. policy on this going to be like?" And it was just kind of like there was no real like commitment to anything. There wasn't a commitment to like, "No, we are well, we you know we are in." We are not gonna care about this is the Egyptian. What happens in Egypt is not our concern. There was not that, so definitely the refusal wasn't there, but there wasn't also like we're gonna help the Egyptian people. There wasn't that either. There was and there wasn't even like, like there was no stance on taking on Egypt. It was finally after all these revolutions, Libya happens, and then the United States government and the UN decide to make it their stance to say this is we're going to intervene, and it's just kind of puzzling to me why Libya. Although there is this kind of there is this book club or study, there's this group that I kind of regularly, not regularly, but I have occasionally gone to, and it's called the Freedom Hall, and they're the it's up in Harlem in New York, and Freedom Hall is a representative of the Freedom Socialist Party, which is its headquarters is based on in Seattle, Washington. So this is a group of this is a very they're against capitalism. So obviously these are kind of the very revolutionary group that really loves revolution, not just for democracy, but for the starting of and propagating of socialism and feminism. So it's a very radical group, right? In the McCarthy eras, these people would have been arrested and blacklisted and stuff like that. So they're not communist by any means, but they're closer to communists than perhaps to libertarians. Libertarians would be like the exact opposite of what socialists are. But anyway, their argument is, of course, that U.S. involvement in Libya it makes sense because Libya is U.S. has interest in oil there. So, and this no-fly zone they're calling, this no-fly zone, is actually a euphemism for bombing. So, what they're doing is they're not allowing the Libyan air forces to operate around the area, but UN air forces and U.S. air forces are free to be there, and they're going to bomb the hell out of the country, the country's forces. And in a way, I don't know, like, what makes this invasion feel a lot different than, I guess, the invasion I do not agree with was which is the Iraq invasion. What makes it different is that this does have a basis in, I guess, humanitarian aid. Gaddafi is a very, you know, kind of, from what I read, he's a horrible dictator, like, you know, like many of the Middle Eastern or North African dictators there are. Horrible dictator, needs to go, really oppresses the people, and, you know, there's going to be, like, you know, and Obama has taken the stance, the president has taken the stance, Congress, like the executive branch at least, has taken the stance that Gaddafi must be fought against and stopped. So for this issue, they've taken the stance. For every other uprising, they haven't taken a stance, which was what I found interesting. But of course, the socialists will argue that's because of the oil interest in Libya. And so while under the guise of humanitarian aid, we are really actually just exploiting another weaker nation for the capitalist gains. That's the socialist argument. It can be pretty convincing, I guess, even if you're not into the whole radical socialist thing. In any case, it's interesting. What the socialists argue, though, is that... what they argue is that the U.S. government should not be the one to intervene because they have their own self-interest, so they would exploit... And kind of, you know, it's not about, to them, it's not about the democracy or the freedom or the well-being of the Libyan people, but it's about their own self-interest. A superpower like United States or Russia or any country should not be the ones to intervene on their behalf, is their argument. Instead, what should intervene on their behalf are the people without those, big self-interests like oil, without the interest of nationalizing anything in Libya or taking anything in Libya, but these groups, international communities of workers, labor unions, and stuff that should provide aid, money, and arms to Libyan people for them to fight their own wars. This is the socialist argument, which I guess is very convincing, very appealing, but at the same time, I guess for humanitarian reasons, Gaddafi is a ruthless murderer with a humongous army, right? He got this huge, humongous army. And really, the only powers that are able to stand up to this army are big countries like United States and France and UK, which is what the UNI forces are made up of. So, I'm really divided on this issue. I really do think the whole... what I really hated about the American journalism, or the Western journalism media, was it talked a lot about no-fly zone. There will be no-fly zone, whatever. But all this time I'm reading this, it's like, what is no-fly zone? What does that even mean? And it wasn't until I talked to a bunch of people that no-fly zone just means pretty much preemptive strike. And it wasn't until I kind of connected the dots. It's called Operation Odyssey Dawn. It's like, operation, it kind of sounds like a military operation. And it is. It is a military operation. It is bombing. Pretty much that's what it is. It kind of worries me, you know? Whenever there's bombing involved, it worries me that it's going to bomb the wrong people. And it's a very detached form of military intervention. So the way this administration is going about it is we are helping Libya. We're providing humanitarian aid. There will be no ground forces, though, of course, CIA operatives and whatnot will be there. Those are not communist ground forces. So there will be no ground forces. There will be no involvement. This is what they promise. And also they promise that, you know, there will be no occupation or no military intervention. It will just strictly be no-fly zone. But what the media failed to address is the fact that, in a way, this no-fly zone is military intervention itself. That's kind of the most dangerous thing about this, where it will go. So a lot of the discussion, I think, surrounding the U.S. involvement in Libya is surrounding the constitutionality of it, which I agree is totally unconstitutional. It's unconstitutional just as much as Bush administration's invasion of Iraq. You know, Congress didn't approve it, so automatically unconstitutional. And so there's that discussion. There's also the discussion of what the future of U.S. involvement in Libya will be. Will there be another kind of occupation of a country like Iraq, which is up in the air? We don't know. That's a good chance, good possibility. So there's a lot of discussion about that, but not about actually what is actually going on, which is, I think, is a shame. And also not a lot of background on what Libya has been through. You know, what has Gaddafi done? And this, I think, I have to research on my own. I have to really read back. Like, most of the issues that come up, current world issues, I'm going to have to read back on my own. Read back on the history of Libya, probably. If I have time, I probably won't have time. But, you know, if I had the time and the energy, these will be the things I really would love to do, is to read back on the history of Libya, read back on who this Gaddafi guy is, what was the U.S. intervention prior to this, because U.S. is engaged with the country, with world all over the world secretly. We're just not aware of it, you know, and what's been going on, and studying up on the history of that, and also what kind of organizations has been around there, what the rebels are like. So really getting the history, the background of Libya would be really amazing to know. And then probably even, and then I would suggest kind of going into the political proposals for Libya. How should U.S. be involved in Libya and stuff like that? I think that should be discussed after the framing of the background, which rarely happens in American debate, which I think is really shameful. And yet again, that's how it's been the case for many cases of U.S. intervention in the world.